Hello, hello. This is Sir David the Bard. I did a little traveling, and I'm standing on Kolob. There's no trees here. There's no water. There's no rocks. It's just gas. Human gas. So, you know, I just had to see Kolob for myself. Okay. You know, I've used my video show to kind of document my life so that I can look at my life and say, what the hell? What was this all about? I think a lot about life and its consequences, where we came from, where we're going, and why we're here. Those are important questions to me. I've come up with very different answers than the Mormons gave me. I keep saying, but you know, the Mormons are so stupid. I didn't get excommunicated. I stayed faithful to my wife. I paid my tithing. I had a temple recommend when I resigned. I didn't get excommunicated. I worked in the temple. I've been in a stake presidency in Hartford, Connecticut a short time. I was in the Elders Quorum presidency for years, and I taught the Elders Quorum for years. I've been married in the Manti Temple, the Washington, D.C. Temple, and the Salt Lake Temple. And I'm a graduate of BYU, so I have some knowledge on the Mormon Church. Please, people, read the comments of the Mormons. They speak for themselves. Anyway, what I wanted to do for myself, like I always tell you, if you don't like it, turn it off. It doesn't matter to me. I've never made a dime. I've got 1,100 videos, and I've never made a dime. They're not worth anything. Anyway, I wanted to go over my life to myself of how many times I've protested being here in this world. Now, you know, I'm bipolar. And I've had open heart quad bypass, and I'm diabetic. So I've laid in hospital beds, and I've had plenty of time to think, what have I done, where am I going, why am I here, and am I afraid? When the priest came in for my quad bypass, he says, do you want me to pray for you? I said, hell no, pray for the surgeon that he does a good job. You don't need to pray for me. Okay, okay. So anyway, I'm thinking back. This started this. I don't know what it is. It's just antisocial and spotting shit. Just spotting shit. Okay, well, let's go back to when I was in kindergarten, first grade. And we used to line up to go outside for PE, and I loved recess. That was my favorite subject. And so, now look how little water is in there. You people that always say, he's drinking. Well, I should be drinking, being down here with you. Anyway, we had a deal where everybody lined up, and I liked being first. I liked being first, because I was the first one out there. I don't know if kids are like that. So my teacher had a parent-teacher conference with my mom. And my mom has related to me. She's dead now. Where the hell she is. Who cares? Anyway. She says, you know, David, your teacher had a conference with me. And she complained about your behavior of having to be the front of the line. And I said, oh. And so she's going to change that line. And I said, well, okay, tell me how and I'll get around it. Says, well, the first person in line has to hold the door for everybody else to go out. So the next couple of weeks, the teacher began to implement. And I could see being first in line is not always the best thing for you and me. So I'm first in line. I always get there first. And I know how stupid human beings are, and I know how to manipulate them. I don't know, it's just bipolar. So I turn to the kid behind me every damn day, or girl, and I say, hey, you want to be first in line? I'll give you cuts. They bow their heads and say yes. Okay, come on up, you be first in line, I'll be second. I was the first one out into the playground. And that started at a very, very young age. Well, went on down through life a little bit, and went into, now remember, I was a hardcore Mormon for many, many years, and so I was a pretty good driver. I still am a driver of the car. People get the hell out of my way now, and I love sunroofs where I can give the official hand signal of the seniors of the world. Anyway, I was entered into a driving contest. I was 16, I think, and I placed really well. I don't know, out of 500 kids, I was like, I don't know, 23rd or 15th or something. And so they had a final runoff of the car contest and the driving skills. So they wrote me a letter and said it's going to be on such and such a day, which was a Sunday. Well, being a hardcore Mormon, being a Mormon and being bipolar, it should be against the law. Should be against the law. So I write to the driving class contest board. It's the Lord's day. You don't do those things on Sunday. I have a right. I have a right. Oh, Lord. Mormons have a right to be total idiots. Let me check on Allison. Where's my brownies and milk? Anyway. The board was so embarrassed that I guess it embarrassed them. They told, I don't remember if he was a senator, Largamasino in California. I think he was a representative or a senator. Well, he wrote me a letter, and he goes, he says, you're right, we're going to change that. It shouldn't take the Sabbath, and you're a good Christian. No, I wasn't, but I thought I was. So anyway, I have a letter from Senator, I think it's Senator Largamasino, and I was, right at 15, 16, protesting the Mormon church. Now, I also remember I was raised in Ojai, California, by Santa Barbara and Ventura, and the newspaper came out there. I don't remember how old I was there, maybe early 20s, I don't know, but the newspaper had a mother holding a baby, and she was a single or an unmarried parent. The baby was illegitimate, so I've got to write. So I write to the paper. Hey, what are you putting an illegitimate child in place of Jesus? Well, now that I think about it, he was illegitimate too, but it never occurred to me back then. Never occurred to me back then. So I protested that, and letters to the editor. If you look that up in the Merriam-Webster dictionary, you'll see my face right there. I wrote more letters to the editor than I had wives. Anyway, going on down through my life there, I do remember that I worked for different people, and I was always getting fired because I would quit before I got fired because I was always protesting, this ain't right. Well, I got a job for Arthur Murray Dance Studio in Salt Lake City, and I'm teaching the girls to dance, and I have to tell you, my little girl Allison says she lost her swag. I go, holy shit, is that serious, Allison? She goes, I don't know. I said, well, what is a snatch? A snatch? Oh, Jesus. God dang. What's wrong with me? I'm in Dementiaville. What is a swag? She goes, being cool. I said, hell, I lost my swag 50 years ago. So anyway, I got to stay off that subject. I'm trying to think the next time I demonstrated. Oh, they're at Arthur Murray's. Well, they were making us work long hours, extra hours, and not paying us overtime, and then we had to go to clubs at night, 2 or 3 days a week, and dance with the old ladies that were at the clubs. Well, there was drinking and smoking, and so I took my Mormon bipolar, just banged the shit out of Arthur Murray, so I sued him. I had several friends there that said, Get them, Bard. Get them. Now, I've learned from this, folks. I've learned from this. When people say, get them, Bard, my asses in the meat grinder, they're just watching the hot dogs and sausage come out. So, anyway, I sued Arthur Murray, and they had an attorney in New York City, and I was trying to start a union. Well, a union in Utah is as satanic as the Church of Satan and ritual child abuse. So I, you know, trying to start a union. So I got the truck drivers gave me a charter, whatever. So anyway, we had a couple of meetings trying to come to a settlement. And I was pretty good at typing and talking and negotiating. And so I got in a meeting with the Arthur Murray executives and the local people. None of my friends were there. They all go, shit, I want to keep my job. I'm getting as far away from this as I can. I've learned. So we're sitting there in a meeting, this conference call. The attorney comes on the phone. He says, are you the Bard? Sir David the Bard? And I go, yeah, hell I am. He says, well, we're the attorneys here in New York City, and we're trying to resolve this, but we think that we may have reached an impasse. I said, oh, really? What's the impasse? He says, well, you wrote us a letter detailing the problems at Arthur Murray's in your viewpoint and what was going on and wrong there. And here's the brownie. Brownie girl. Yeah. Did you make these?
No, sister did.
Oh, good. Okay, thanks.
Still waiting for something.
Okay, I'm on. We'll shut the door. Oh, for the take you sledding?
Yeah.
All right, let me finish this video and then I will.
Bye.
So anyway, he said, well, you wrote this letter to us and it's extensive, and you typed it on toilet paper. What's wrong with me? I did. So he said, we don't think that's very respectful. I said, well, when we're done with the lawsuit, you can use it at least. Anyway, that went to shit, just like every other protest I've ever had. The world is the world. We're not going to change it. So, I got screwed at Arthur Murray's. But I did stand up for myself. And let me tell you another situation. This is on the videos out of the 1100. And I hate to repeat anything. I don't repeat anything. I work for Mr. and Mrs. Merriam. They own the Merriam-Webster dictionary when I was 15 to 19. And we had an asshole son and more money than they knew what to do with. And I used to take care of the father, and the mother came to me and said, Sir David the Bard, you really seem like a responsible person. We'd like to send you to the World's Fair, and I want you to take my 14-year-old son. I was about 16. Hey, sounds like a good deal. So I took Alan to New York. He poured honey all over the mattresses, between the mattresses and some of the finest hotels in New York City. Anyway, we got up to Montreal to the World's Fair, and they had a tram, a monorail tram moving the people around. I got on it with Alan, and we were sitting there, and pretty soon three little girls got on, and they might have been 9, 10, 11, and they all had this little trinket around their neck that they bought. I didn't think anything of it, and pretty soon two old bags come in, probably Mormons, and sat down beside me, and I wasn't going to harass them. I was just looking out the window. Well, this one old bag reaches over to the little child and grabs her necklace, and bam, rips it off the kid. The kid bursts into tears, just started crying and crying, and I looked at the old bitch, and I said, what the fuck? What's going on here? She said, well, she stole it. I said, how do you know she stole it? Well, she's a nigger. They steal everything. I says, the other two girls have the same necklace. And they're white. That's right. I'm taking the nigger's necklace. I said, well, I said, I don't think so. Here I go. I don't know how I get into these situations, but anyway, these cars had automatic doors on them. So I got up and I stood in the automatic door, and the car, train can't move if the door doesn't close. So pretty soon the siren goes off and the police come running down to the car and they say, you need to get out of the door. And I said, well, the bitch needs to give back the necklace. And the guy looked at the bitch and said, how come you took the kid's necklace? She said, because she's a nigger. And the police take her off the train. I get out of the doorway and the little girl gets her necklace back, and down the road we go. So, you know, I was right about 16 when that happened. And then my daughter, Monica, my ex-daughter, Monica, she had 5 years of seminary, not four. Now, I'll tell you why. The church only allows 4 years of seminary. It doesn't allow 5 years. So when she went to seminary for 4 years, she wanted to go one more year. And so I went to the church, if you want to call it, educational system. And I said, what the hell? The kid wants to go to another year of seminary. And they go, no, she can't. I said, all right. We'll see. Because the bar don't take no for an answer. So I had a friend, John Hunter, who was the Hunter Prophet. What was his name? Damn it. Anyway, President Hunter's son. And he was the prophet of the Mormon Church and the leader. So I went to John because I know I can get to the prophet real quick through his son, Howard Hunter. Howard Hunter. So I went to John and I said, John, listen, I don't want to make trouble. He goes, David, you are trouble. You look in the dictionary, there's your face again, trouble. I said, well, listen, I want my daughter to be able to go to another year of seminary, and the church office education there says that she can't do it. And I'm thinking of just walking with a sign out front of the church that says, Mormon prophet will not let child go to Bible study. And you could see John's face go, oh, shit. So I guess he called his dad. Howard calls back. Howard used to come to our ward, even as the prophet there in Ohio. He'd show up to see his sons and grandchildren. And so John comes to me a couple of days later, and he says, you got it. She's registered. So when she graduated, she got a 4-year seminary pin and a 5th-year letter. I think she's the only child that ever had 5 years of seminary. So I had to stand up for her and be an advocate. And then later on, she went to Europe and learned French and Italian and a few languages. And she was only probably, I don't know, 17, something like that, 16. And she came back and she had already graduated from high school. Well, I've got now a 16 or 17-year-old girl that's graduated. I wanted her to go off to BYU. So I called BYU because their requirements said that you had to be 18 and a high school graduate. Well, I called them and said, hey, this is Sir David the Bard. Because I had graduated from there. They knew me. They knew me. Then I tried to stand up for what's right. So I said, my Monica wants to register. And they said, well, she can't. I said, I'm not sure what you're saying is true. She has a high school diploma. She's just not 18. Well, we went round and round, and we did the hokey pokey. And finally, Monica registered at BYU and graduated and is now married. So anyway, that was another one of my standing up for what's right. Now, here's another one I had at BYU, two of more. One of them was I had a date. Believe it or not, somebody was willing to go out with me, and it wasn't a guy. So I took her home after the dance, and the snow had impacted or packed on a sign. So you couldn't see the sign when I drove her into her parking lot to let her off at Heritage Halls. Well, while I stopped, and I wasn't there 30 seconds, I was just letting her out of the car, and I already felt her up. No, no, God, What's wrong? I did take my meds today. So anyway, I didn't walk her to the door. I just, you know, started backing out, and here comes the police cars. They all pull up behind me. I think there was two cars. Guy gets out and says, "You're in an illegal area." And I said, "Well, how would I know that?" He says, "That sign right there." It was pure white, packed with like 3 inches of snow. You didn't even know it was a sign. I said, "I couldn't read that." He says, "Doesn't matter. Revelation told us give you a ticket." I said, "Hellfire. You know, I'm just an ordinary person here. I just drove in to let the girl off, and I'm backing out." "No, no, no." So he gave me a ticket. Well, I had to read it. You know, it had a bunch of stuff in it. And at BYU in those days, there was a process that you paid the ticket, number one. You just bow your damn head and say, "Yes, sir," and you paid the ticket. Then you could go to a judge on an appeal and beg for your money back. Now, I was only, I don't know, what, 18 or 19 at BYU there when I started. And I said, "That doesn't sound right. I think that when you have an appeal, everything is stayed until the decision on the appeal." So I went to the administration building, and they go, "Holy shit, here comes that guy, Sir David the Bard. He's probably going to make videos in his old age about us." So anyway, I got called into, what do they call it, ethics, it's not ethics, into a disciplinary council. And the psychiatrist was there, and he said, "What do you think the problem is?" And I said, "Well, the problem is that on an appeal, that system should be changed. You don't pay the ticket first. You see the judge first. The judge makes the final decision, and then you pay." And he said, "Well, you have two choices. We're going to kick you out of BYU." I'm not surprised. I don't fit here. I'm not a yes man. And I just wear a Calvin Klein underwear. Not that Omar the Tent Maker thing. Anyway, he says, "Okay, we're going to kick you out of BYU, or you can write an illustrated or documented paper about how we should change the system." Well, I wrote the paper, and they let me stay, and they did change the system like a year later. So if I had something to do with it, I don't know. Well, anyway, while we were in academic... What's that? I don't, it's on the tip of my tongue. Maybe I could get it. Nope. I haven't done that for a while. Anyway, he says, "We think there's something wrong with you." And I said, "My mother did since birth. What's the deal?" And he says, "Well, here's the deal. You have to take a psychological test." I said, "Hell, I don't have any psychological." He says, "We know, but we just want you to take the test." I said, "Okay, I'll take your damn test." So it was like 500 questions, and it was multiple choice, and one of the choices was, "Does not apply." So I wrote down 500, "Does not apply." And in those days, they had to send the test off to a testing center to grade it and then come back. Well, he calls me in like 3 or 4 days later, and he says, "You know why you're here?" "Could be many reasons." "No, just narrow it down if you want me to guess." So he said, "This test was a waste of time." I said, I know that, but you had to get the information for yourself." So anyway, I got to stay at BYU. Well, that's one of my BYU stories. Now the other one is, I was living over at Chipman Hall, and I bought a 56 Chevy, and it wasn't fast or fancy. It was just a regular 56 Chevy, but it could have been cool if I'd been rich. And right after I got the ticket in the parking lot, I wake up one morning and I'm going to go to work, because I was working as a freshman and a sophomore at BYU because I didn't have Romney money. And I went to start my car and it wouldn't start, and I opened the hood. The manifold and the carburetors were all gone. I go, "God, where was security?" It was right there under my apartment at BYU, in a BYU parking lot. Security is over giving me illegal tickets, trying to charge me, and the criminals are over, got my hood open, and an A-frame. under my hood pulling off the manifold. So, I'm pissed now. So I had to replace it, get it all going again. And so I painted, and I repeated this on another video, and I'm sorry. I painted on the left door, the right door, the trunk, and the hood, BYU security, go to hell. Then I drove the car up on campus. I didn't want it to be a big deal, but as I was driving, there were cheering people. It was kind of like Hitler coming into a meeting. So I drove it right up by the Marriott Center, and right in the center there where Hinckley put his alumni building now. That I refused to go into. And so I drove it back home, and I'm sitting in my dorm, and I hear this, well, holy shit, I don't know anybody. And I know it's not a girl, so I go over, and here's three or four BYU security officers standing in my door. And they say, are you Sir David the Bard? I said, are you the policeman? It looks like it to both of us. He goes, okay. Is that your car downstairs? Oh, yeah, it is. You need to come with us. So I'm back up in academic, what do they call that? I want an academic standards. I'm up in academic standards again, and I'm under scrutiny again, and I'm being screwed with again. So they knew me. And well, about 10 years ago, I applied for my PhD at BYU, and they turned me down because I had resigned from the Mormon Church. The only person that cannot go to BYU is a person who has resigned from the Mormon Church. So anyway, those are my BYU stories. Well, life goes on, and this is going to be a little bit out of chronological order. Mercy, my wife from the Philippines, came home when she was first working. And she said that she was trying to order something at McDonald's, and she didn't speak very good English when she came here. And so the McDonald's employee made fun of her, and she came home crying. In the Bard family, that don't fly. So I get dressed, I go down to McDonald's, and I go, hey, this is Sir David the Bard, and this is my wife, and you insulted her. Well, they gave us food for like months at that McDonald's to repent. So I stood up for it and whatever. And I do remember I had a situation where my son came home, and he must have been 7th grade, maybe 6th grade, and he was crying. And his name is David Adam. And I said, Adam, what the hell's the problem? He said, there's this kid at school, and he keeps beating me up. Well, that don't fly with the Bard either. So I call the school, I make some complaints, and the kid keeps beating my kid up. So I take Adam to school one day, and I said, do you see the kid on the playground? He says, yeah, he's right there. And I says, don't even say anything. Just walk over and hit him in the face as hard as you can. Adam did. Bard, come in the office. So I've always been in the principal's office, so here I go again. I'm in the principal's office. He said, you can't come on this campus anymore. I said, I don't think I'll have to. I think the kid got the message. I left. God. When I go over this stuff, I wonder why I've never been in jail. Well, anyway, going on down the list, you know, I have an autistic son, Aaron. And I had defended him for 18 years in the Ojai School District. And we had what they call those fair hearings or due process hearings, where I was always suing the school because they didn't want to spend any money on him. And so one day, there was a big hearing coming up, and the Ojai School District hired a law firm out of Orange County. Now that's probably 150, 200 miles away. And it was a big, expensive law firm. And so they came down, and I'm just sitting in a little chair by myself with my teddy bear, and I'm the one that's suing everybody. So the law firm, I brought all the boxes in, all of the evidence, and I had it all piled up, and I was ready to go. The Bard was ready to go. And so they came in, and all they had was a little pencil. Holy shit, they're going to beat me with a pencil? Don't they have any evidence or anything? I go, hey, well, I'm just going to go ahead and kick their ass. And so the judge came in and said, you know, we're ready to start this hearing. Are you ready, Mr. Bard? And I go, yeah, I'm ready. These assholes are not giving my son the proper education that he's promised under federal law. So then he turns to the guy with the pencil. And he says to this, and there were like three or four attorneys there from this law firm. He says, are you ready to proceed? And they go, no, Your Honor. I go, hell, I carry all this shit. We're not going to proceed. Did I win? Did I lose? I don't know. And so the judge says, well, why? And they said, well, we want to bifurcate, which means cut up the lawsuit. We want to take certain pieces of it and just hear a piece at a time. And so the judge says, okay, I'm going to allow for bifurcation and set a new hearing like 2 weeks down the road. I have to carry all those boxes out, and these guys are skipping and laughing and going, ha! We got the Bard. 2 weeks later, the hearing shows up, and he looks down. Now these assholes have all these boxes that they got from the hotel. They had to come down and stay overnight, and all these boxes and evidence of federal, special ed and whatever. So there was three or four of them there. And the judge looks down, and he says, okay, we're here to try this. And attorneys, are you ready to go? Yeah, we're going to kick his ass this time. He went out crying last time. Okay. So the judge looks over to me, and he says, are you ready to go? No, Your Honor. Jesus Christ, what's wrong now? I said, well, I have a disability. I have a mental disability, and I'm not prepared to go forward until about two or three more weeks. And the attorneys on the other side jumped up and just danced on the table and go, he can't do this. He has no proof. He can't do it. I let him dance, and I played the violin for him a little bit. And the judge looks at me, and he says, do you have any proof? I said, well, I wouldn't come into a court without proof. Here's a letter from my doctor. The judge looks at it and says, this case is extended for 2 weeks, and it'll be on whatever date. And I go, and the attorney's picking up all those boxes and walking out with all those boxes. So, you know, you can screw with the Bard, but you can't screw him all the time. So anyway, that was another situation where I stood up for myself and my family. And we eventually won that lawsuit. And what's really funny, I remember my son was on a bus, my retarded son, autistic son, and they sent him to another school because they didn't want him over at their school, and someone beat the crap out of him on the bus, and so he came home crying, and I called the school up, and I said, this is Sir David the Bard. Said, hold on just a second, let's get the administrator of the Department of Education here. So anyway, I called him, and I said, this sucks, and it did. So I stood up for Aaron again, and they gave him an aide on the bus, and then the aide couldn't control the kids either, and so I insisted on a taxi cab, that he was picked up every morning by a taxi and transported to school safely. So I stood up for him there, and glad that I did. I have been an advocate. I have been an advocate for the retarded and the displaced and the people who are being taken advantage of. So, you know, this is starting to be a long video now, so maybe I can come up with a few more. I know there's a few more out there, but I'm going to let it go at this, that I want my kids to be able to handle these videos when I'm gone. I could be gone tomorrow, and maybe they'll say, gee, Dad was not as bad as the Mormon Church said that he was. I've got one right here. I've been trying to get on. Can I get that up on my camera? Yeah, well, down, over. Yeah, city court reporting that basically I sued South Jordan School District over my two girls in the Philippines. They wouldn't give them any help or services while the kids were still being adopted in the Philippines, and I sued him, and there's hours and hours of video there, and I stood up for that, and then finally I could see the judge and the prosecutor, or the opposing attorney, had been having coffee together, and at the halfway through the court hearing, I got up and left. They were pissed. They were pissed. It was like Christmas time, and all these people were lined up because I had subpoenaed them from the state Department of Education, and they're just screaming and yelling, and the attorney saying, "I want sanctions. I want attorney fees." And the judge says he can leave anytime he wants. You're not going to get it. So I was going to put that up on the video, and when I get a chance, I will. But I just want you to know that it says that for evil to triumph is simply good men doing nothing. And that's what happens with the Mormons. They've gotten away with everything because good men have not stood up and go, "What the hell? You can't do this. You can't treat people like this." So anyway, if I come up with any more, I may put them up, I may not. But there certainly is there a long history of me seeing the shit down here and not wanting to be part of it and standing up, and people hate me. I told you that I've been banned from 3 different places here, in fact 4 different places in Utah, the Davis School District and the furniture store downtown, and the mortgage company that screwed us. They all put up trespass orders against me. So anyway, you know, when I see shit, I just gotta say something, and the nice thing about it is I can, and I do.